one of the most important decisions a person has to take is finding a good job and a professional environment. For many of us, a move abroad is often motivated by potential financial advantages. We want to make more money working abroad than we can back home. Sure, nice weather and living in a fantastic location are great incentives, but money is often the real driving factor. With hard work and effort, expats are often able to change their own financial status dramatically, as well as the wealth of their families and loved ones.
Assalamu alaikum and hi, good afternoon everyone. Welcome to PD Talk Series 3.0. This is your host speaking. My name is NurQamarina and I'm going to be your host for today. So on behalf of my team, I would like to thanks to our PD advisor, Madam Azwin, for giving us the opportunities to conduct this PD Talk. We also would like to welcome our speaker, live from Hong Kong, Ms. Ezzwanee Ahmad. Last but not least, not to forget our participants. I see that we have a lot of participants today, right, Fatin? From 5A and also 5B. 5C pun ada, wow.
Yeah, amazing. It's a good sign actually, Gama. Even though talk kita ni, kita buat petang, but participant tu agak ramai. I didn't expect this at all.
Yeah, that's true, Fatin. And we need to give a big applause lah to them for making time with us, even though during on their busy day, right?
Yeah, so, thank you.
Thank you, guys. So we hope that everyone will learn a lot today and also gain a lot of knowledge from this program.
We are here today to explore the topic about working abroad, opportunities and challenges. I am the co-host for today's talk. My name is Fatin Sakinah. And now I would like to welcome my teammates to introduce themselves, starting from the first moderator.
Hi, I'm the first moderator. My name is Muhammad Qayyum Amri, and you can call me Qayyum. Thank you for joining us.
Hi everyone, my name is NorShamiza and I'm the second moderator. Everyone good? Okay, ready?
Hello and hi, Assalamualaikum. My name is Hukama and I'm your third moderator for today.
Hi, my name is Abgori and I will handle the multimedia.
And hi, my name is Noor Ezzwanee and I will handle technical.
So now, I will proceed to the introduction of our speaker. So, Ms. Noor Ezzwanee Ahmad, she is the Trade Commissioner of the Consulate General of Malaysia, Hong Kong and Macau. Before this, she is the director of Madrid Southern Region. She's also Malaysia's first female trade commissioner in the Embassy of Malaysia in Santiago, Chile.
Did you know, Fatin, besides all of that, she also used to be in marketing, business development, and also event management in the tourism industry. She is also the exporters development and international trade promotion with Madrid.
Oh wow, so Miss Ezzwanee is a really powerful woman, eh, Kama? She really inspired me just by looking at her work experience.
Yes, exactly, she is. I really adore her from the day I know about her. So that's all for now from us. We will move the spotlight to the moderator and also speaker. Have a great day and enjoy!
Enjoy!
Okay, thank you for the warm welcome from our lovely host. Okay, good afternoon everyone. Okay, semua dah makan ke? Kena hari ni lemau.
Hi everyone.
Sini sikit. Hi.
Mana speaker? Speak panel you tak invite lagi ke?
Ada.
Dah.
Tak nampak ni. Oh, hi. Hello.
Glowing sangat tak nampak.
Yeah. You kena pin ni. Special all the way daripada Hong Kong. Yeah. Hello, Mrs. Ezzwanee. How are you?
Hi, Puan Azwin. Thank you very much for and the team for having me to as the guest speaker for today's PD Talk series.
We have so many questions for you.
Soalan sensasi banyak ni.
Seram pula.
Okay, to those who just joined in, sekarang kita ada Miss Ezzwanee who is from Madrid and currently working in Hong Kong. We are very thrilled and very thankful to have you here, Miss. Very sorry kalau kacau masa Miss.
Miss dekat mana sekarang Miss? Work from home ke kat office?
Nah, in Hong Kong now kita dah start balik work in office. So so now in office currently.
Oh, okay.
Cuaca sana macam mana? Okay, like sini.
Cuaca now is a mendung, cloudy now because it's the rainy season. So thunderstorm goes on and off lah basically, but generally it's a summer in Hong Kong and it's very hot.
So how's the traffic? I understand Hong Kong is quite dense, kan? They're very highly density.
Yeah. I mean, Hong Kong is a very dense city, tapi not a lot of them drive. So because the public transportation here are good. So I would say like generally people take public transportation because they are efficient and reliable. So jam-wise, not as bad as Malaysia. So because kita naik taxi, naik bus, MTR here in Hong Kong. So yeah, I mean, I driving here is easy.
Okay. <Yeah. laughs> So you drive there, yeah?
On and off, depends on where I go, but generally when I go for meetings, we drive, and it depends on the place lah, because in Hong Kong, the car parks are limited, so sometimes it's hard to drive, so you have to take public transportation. Yeah.
Just like Singapore jugalah ni.
Lebih kurang lah. If you can say, if you've never been to Hong Kong, you can look at Singapore, it's similar.
Okay, nice. Thank you.
Having a very wonderful person here, Miss. Sebab kita orang sebagai student, kita orang ODL ni, kita usually talk to classmates, lecturers. So for today, we have the chance to talk to you, Miss. It's very
yes. Dia orang dah bosan dengan saya. Ya? Mana ada? Tak cukup seminggu tu. Tak cukup dua kelas. Kena tambah lagi. Dapat speaker dari Hong Kong pula, excited dia.
Itulah benefit kan talk ni kan. Kita dapat experience first hand sendiri daripada Miss Ezzwanee. Miss Ezzwanee pun dah dekat abroad for like almost 10 years kan. Yeah. Mesti banyak tips and trick Miss ada kan.
InsyaAllah lah, mana-mana yang I can share and you know, and give advice to everyone here, especially the young ones today. InsyaAllah, mana siapa-siapa nak tanya tu, do you have that burgeoning question, you know, that you've been, you know, always tanya. Nak tanya orang yang kerja overseas ni kan, mana-mana yang I boleh tolong, if it's not from my own experiences, I can relate to my friends' experiences. So insyaAllah mana-mana I boleh bagi jawapan tu or bagi answer tu, insyaAllah I will help.
InsyaAllah pasti boleh. So but we are going to talk about the topic in a minute. Miss Ezzwanee, let's talk a little bit about you. People don't know as much about your background. We all know as an organizing committee, you have a hugely varied background in matrik, working outside Malaysia and things like that. So, Miss, will you give a few words before we start?
Okay, so first of all, I lupa nak cakap thank you for having me again. So, basically, I'm 45 years old. So, I was a graduate from, back then it was UiTM. I was from tourism as well.
UiTM.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And then I further study in Multimedia University. Then after MMU, I work in a tourism event company. Then I got to know about matrik. So now, dah nearly 16 years I've been with matrik. So with matrik, I'm not sure if you know about matrik. Matrik is the National Trade Promotion Agency.
Yeah.
So we are under the Ministry of International Trade Industry. So what we do, matrik specifically, we help promote Malaysian products and services overseas. So we help Malaysian companies, especially small and medium size companies, promote their products, find buyers for them, and link them up, you know. So that's our main job lah. So in particular, in overseas offices, so that's our main job lah. We have to promote Malaysian trade and investment. So in particular, in overseas offices, I was posted in Chile back in 2012, Chile, South America. So I was in Santiago for about four years until 2016. And then I was cross-posted to Hong Kong. Now been in Hong Kong for the past 5 years. Yeah, so all in all, I've been working abroad for nearly 9 years. This July, 9 years. Wow. Yes.
Which is already July.
Yes, yeah. End of July, exactly 1 year. 9 years. Yeah.
Happy anniversary.
That's an amazing background from our speaker. So, Miss, saya ada soalan macam, okay, working abroad ni menjadi sesuatu yang agak susah untuk someone. Kalau dia fikir firstly about the cost. Okay, cost untuk kita working abroad. First, maybe they need to relocate. Okay, maybe dia punya expenses. Dia punya visa application. So, certain company dia akan cover the expenses. And ada company yang tak. So, untuk Miss, apa experience ni tentang deciding to work abroad ni? Miss, di cover ke macam mana?
Okay. So generally, when people work abroad, they either you study abroad and you continue working abroad, and then your existing company di Malaysia or di mana-mana ask you to transfer to another country, or you in Malaysia ke, you apply to work in another country, right? Either in companies or maybe headhunters, you know, found you and offer you a job in a foreign country. So basically, usually when people want to work abroad, generally they want to gain work experience, right? So in a way to broaden their knowledge and skills. So, and some people also want better pay, right? So the illusion that sometimes working abroad, you have a better pay, right? Okay, but fortunately for me, I work with Matrade, kan? So Matrade, we have about 46 offices overseas. So when you start working in Matrade, you will sign a surat lah saying that you will be posted abroad. So generally, I know that I will be working abroad. So, but still, for when we are posted abroad, it's a life-changing punya decision, right? So there's a lot of things that you need to take into consideration, like what you said, you know, just now. The cost, relocating cost, visa and everything, right? So, alhamdulillah, for me, a lot of it are covered by, under my package, you know? So, they're covered by the company. So, basically, when I got to know about the decision that I was about to be sent overseas, I think they gave me about 6 months back in 2012. 6 months before July 2012, kata, Ezzwanee, you kena transfer pergi Santiago, Chile. So within that 6 months tu, you akan pergi, if I'm not mistaken, dia beritahu I in January, and I had to go to Chile in July. So I have about roughly 6 months to prepare. I was in Johor that time, I was in the office Johor. So yeah, so within that 6 months, I have to attend courses. I have to move my things from Johor to KL. I have to readjust everything, jual kereta lah, rumah nak make sure siapa nak rent ke, nak jual ke, yeah. So family lagi nak beritahu semua. So yeah, within that 6 months, I had to do it. Luckily, I'm single, so you know it's quite straightforward. So yeah, just imagine if someone dah ada anak yang sekolah or husband, you know, yeah, it'll be harder. So yeah, I mean, it's basically within 6 months, I pergi kursus and everything, pack up everything. July, I flew to Chile. Yeah, so it's hard. It was hard. And especially, you have to consider also that initial budget that when you want to go abroad, right? Regardless lah, if company bayar ke tak certain things, you have to have your personal allocation for you to start your life abroad, right? So yeah, I mean, so there's a lot of things that you have to consider lah before. One, if you have to move abroad, but if you sendiri nak move abroad, there are a lot of things yeah you have to consider lah.
Rasa-rasanya, Miss Ezzwanee, if it was not covered by company, what kind of amount yang, you know, we need to prepare lah to organize relocation, visa application and all that, roughly?
It's hard to like estimate every country tu lain-lain kan?
Right, right.
So generally you kena initial tu, you kena consider that home, right, house, that initial cost tu. Then you kena ada deposit semua. Kalau company bayar, dulukan semua, carikan semua, no issue, right? But if you kena cari sendiri, you have to cari temporary room ke, house, hotel ke dulu. And then you kena visa cost tu kan. So benda ni semua takes into account when whether the package that offered by companies tu cover all these things or not. So before moving abroad, you have to ask your employer or the ones the offering you that job whether benda ni cover ke tak, right? Kalau tak cover tu, like I said, it's hard to consider a specific amount. Tapi generally, I would say you have to basically, it's like for the first 1 month, you have to contain your expenses kan. So it's hard to put an amount because country, different country, lain-lain. So if you go to a developed country, dia mahal lagi harga dia kan. So kalau you go to a relatively cheaper country, mungkin tak berapa tinggi kan. Yeah, so I think initially tu, maybe you need to, I would say like simpan minimum 3 bulan gaji dulu yang you dapat sebelum tu. It depends also your gaji, right? So, yeah. But at least I would say comfortably at least ada $10,000 dulu.
$10,000?
Yeah, at least. That is being very, that is being very, apa?
Reasonable lah.
I would say that depends on the country, there will be more. Tapi I would say kalau cakap untuk initial preparation tu, you have to at least ada duit jugalah.
Tapi saya wondering lah, Miss. Yelah kan, kalau nak buat keputusan tu, lagi-lagi kalau soal bahasa, orang kata language barrier lah, sebab saya rasa kat dalam ni semua setujulah kalau kita lagi-lagi macam Miss kan, Miss daripada Malaysia nak ke Hong Kong, nak cakap bahasa di sana, so boleh jadi satu masalah yang besar lah. Lagi-lagi kalau orang yang nak travel ataupun work abroad, yang mana English tu is not the main language.
Macam
Korea, China, South America, Russia. So basically macam mana sebagai seorang yang dah pengalaman dalam dunia industri macam ni,
especially in Chile lah, especially
For me, I would say the hardest experience was when I was in Chile, because as you know, Chile, South America, there's predominantly Spanish speaking, right? So I went there just about 1 month worth of English, Spanish language. So I had to take a basic Spanish course. You know, tak sempat kan? Like I said, I had only 6 months. So pergi sana, I thinking that is a very international country. So sampai sana hotel pun tak cakap English. So it was hard. It was hard when you nak tanya certain things, right? So I realized that when there's not a lot of people can speak English. So I had to really put a lot of effort to learn the language, right? So it's hard for me also because at the same time, I'm working, right? So it's not simply that you can just take time off to learn language somewhere, right? So in the end, I had to work and learn at the same time. It took me about 1 year to really converse in Spanish. Not good conversation, but at least orang paham, orang sana faham, I can speak Spanish. And I can understand them back, yeah.
Miss, ingat lagi.
Mi Espanol es muy mal. Meaning, it's not that good. Mi nombre es Ezzwanee. My name is Ezzwanee. So, yeah, basically, it's hard because Spanish is not an easy language also to learn. So dia Latin kan, so dia you kena ada past tense, present tense lah, laki perempuan. So yeah, it was hard. So So in the end, I really rely on my staff, right? Mm. My local, my colleagues there, yeah. To help me with the language. I think among the first things that I learned was numbers, you know? Mm. So because I think I need to know numbers. Like I nak kena sign check. So I need to know what I'm apa the amount kan? Mm. Because nak sign check pun, you kena tulis in Spanish, tak boleh in English. So I need to know kan the word what I'm signing tu supaya I faham. Then I nak pergi market ke apa ke semua, you know, people cannot, supermarket besar-besar pun cannot speak Spanish. So in the end, you just like every day tu you keep on going out and tengok TV pun memainkan peranan. So dengan ada subtitle and everything, right? So you just lama-lama tu you have to, in a way, when you need to survive, dia macam somehow cepat sikit nak belajar, right? So yeah, so it's hard. In Hong Kong, not so much, because generally in Hong Kong people can speak English. Tapi from time to time tu adalah kan orang yang tak cakap balik English to you, but you kind of like, oh, okay lah, dah understand lah apa dia apa dia nak cakap kan, konteks yang dia nak cakap tu. Yeah, but it's important lah for you to in any country, especially non English speaking countries, you have to learn the language first. That will make your life easier. You know, no basic things like, you know, the basic pergi, nak pergi mana, how much, mana nak pergi tempat tu. And then I would say like Google was my best friend. Sebab Google ni kalau, especially kalau you nak cari tempat, right? So when you can't converse in the local language, you can input the location in Google, and you set up Google in that local language, dia keluar local language. Right, especially kalau Chinese, macam kat Hong Kong, dia in Chinese character, right? So it's helpful lah. Tu antara my tools that I still use to go around in Hong Kong.
So, Miss, as a person, ada apa? Maksudnya language yang Miss mahir. Yang saya tahulah, bahasa Melayu, English, Spanish, and Madam Mazen dah beritahu, Japanese, betul?
Oh yeah, when I was in ITM, I
beda Azin cakap,
learn Japanese,
compete.
But that was years ago. So sikit-sikit tu I ingat.
Masih ingat lagi ya?
But it's hard when you don't converse with people kan. Spanish ni pun kat Hong Kong tak ramai I jumpa Spanish speaking people. So lama-lama when you don't practice, lama-lama you lupa lah, right?
Betul.
So yeah, sikit-sikit tu kadang teringat lah Japanese. But yeah, it's I don't put it in my resume anymore.
Handsome tak dekat Chile?
Argentinian sama more handsome. I suka pergi Argentina.
Kena cuci mata.
Do they get confused where you are from over there?
Of course.
Right.
Somehow my face ni, muka Melayu ni, muka macam muka South American. Right. So generally people don't bother me much if I just keep low profile. You know, when I start to speak, then they realize that I'm a foreigner, right? Mm. But generally they are quite curious lah, tengok muka macam South American, muka macam Peruvian ke mana-mana kan, tapi right, tak right. Boleh cakap Spanish. Cakap Spanish pun macam tak betul, right? So yeah, but then they ask me daripada mana. Dia confused lah juga. Then bila I cakap daripada Malaysia, mostly tak tahu kat mana Malaysia.
Yes.
In Chile, so I kena explain kat mana-mana Malaysia. Lagi pula kalau dia tahu I Muslim, lagilah dia tanya lagi. But generally they are very curious people lah in the South American side. Kalau dia jarang jumpa Asian. For them, Asia is China. So right. It's hard explaining to them yang kita ada Malaysian, banyak kita ada lagi. Indonesian, kita ada banyak lagi kan, Indian, you know. It's hard for them to understand that concept.
Friendly lah kat sana.
Ya? Yeah?
Kat sana friendly.
Generally friendly lah. Like I would say like there are two types of South Americans, ya. Yeah? So the South American yang datang daripada Europe, you tahu kan, South America is built up by Europeans migrating to South America, and there are the indigenous South American. So meaning ya, macam dia Peruvian, dia Bolivian, yang memang indigenous people. So I find that the indigenous people tu are more friendlier than the yang datang ni. So because pada dia European, right? So they have a hard time a bit warming up to people, while the locals are very open, very welcoming to foreigners. Yeah.
So Miss okay, Kecili tu, Miss ada pergi kelas ke tu Miss belajar dengan kawan you?
Language saya sendiri je. So because I, like I said, my work there demands a lot of my time. So I had to learn in between. So my staff tolong ajar and ada kelas sekali I pergi. So I didn't commit 100% belajar betul-betul. I think kalau I commit betul-betul 100%, I will be much more fluent. But I belajar sikit-sikit-sikit. So but it help lah. At least I can go out and people understand. But generally, if on during business meetings, people can understand English because they are all businessmen, right? So but they will talk back in Spanish. Dia takkan cakap balik in English.
Yeah, try on their language again.
Yes, yes.
So talking about language, kita can move on to the next hot topic is discrimination. So discrimination ni boleh jadi macam-macam race, ethnic, even language tu boleh jadi discrimination. Tapi I think Miss mungkin pernah kena discriminate gender. Sebab Miss kan macam woman in power. So macam orang akan cakap, if like you put woman in charge, they be like too emotional, too sensitive. Tak boleh lah letak woman in charge ni. So Miss pernah tak experience benda ni? Macam mana Miss handle?
Generally, I think discrimination ni ada exist everywhere, right? So especially on gender discrimination ni exist more in a country where the country is predominantly male-dominated country, right? Or they have this patriarchal society, right? Community. So yang put men in charge of the everything, right? So I would say, like, based from my experiences traveling and working in Chile and Hong Kong, I don't feel much of that gender discrimination. All right, so because in the global business community, as you can see, there's a lot of women CEOs now. So I meet a lot of very powerful women either in South America. Generally, it's more in Asia, I would say so. We are more open. Surprisingly, we are more open to women heading a company. In South America too, they are still a male-dominated country, but participation of women in workplace too a lot, right? So I don't feel that when I approach certain businessmen too, or dia tak nak, tak macam ada certain Middle Eastern countries, right? It's hard for women to talk to businessmen. So you have, but in the end you have to respect that, right? Because it's culture. In the end it's culture. So even though kita orang Muslim sama-sama, Malaysia kita lain sikit kan, as compared to Middle East. So in Hong Kong pun, I think I would say, like, in Hong Kong, I face that race discrimination. It's not because dia tak suka orang Asia ke apa benda kan, tapi it's more on, okay, generally in Hong Kong ni, orang Southeast Asia, mainly Filipino and Indonesians, are working in the service sector, which is they are mostly maid, right? So when muka Southeast Asian ni, oh, muka yang pakai tudung ni datang Hong Kong, dia ingat kita maid. Alright? So when they think that you are a maid, diorang pun layan kita macam nak tak nak. Alright? So this is when basically you have here in Hong Kong, I dress well. Alright? I dress well and speak in a certain authoritative tone to show that I am not a maid, right? Yeah. So if you pakai cikai-cikai biasa-biasa ni, memang dia memang automatically diingatkan you maid, either Filipino or Indonesian. So that's the hard part, because memang nampak sangat perbezaan darjat tu, right?
Betul.
So
banyak Malay ke kat sana?
Antara dua darjat, eh?
Ya, yeah, yeah. Ramai maids. Kita dekat sini, Filipino ada about 200,000 maids.
Ramai.
Indonesian ada about 150,000. Ramai. So yeah, I mean, bila you pergi kedai or you pergi pergi in business not so much sebab generally people know that orang business is orang expat mainly, right? But if you pergi on the your daily errands ni, pergi supermarket, pergi market ke mana-mana or pergi restaurant, right? Generally diingatkan kita ni apa you know the working level punya side. So yeah, that's when you yourself, you know, it's hard to change their mindset kan, sebab itu yang dia dah nampak every day in their life. But you sendiri lah kena tunjuk. So kat sini, kat Hong Kong ni terpaksa lah dress well, you know, you have to be brand conscious sikit, pakai proper, so that dia nampak lah yang kita ni, oh okay, you know, the way you talk also, generally when you tak, you speak Malay tu dia dah tahu ni bukan Filipino or Indonesian kan. Sometimes discrimination from the mates tu sendiri, dia pun ingatkan kita kan. So you know all these things lah. So I feel more discriminated here in Hong Kong than Chile. Yeah.
Chile dia border sikit, dia tak kisahlah.
Yeah, sebab dia terlalu jauh. So dia terlalu jauh that dia tak exposed to certain dia tak exposed to the world, right? Sebab dia jauh, dia dekat ujung dunia sana. So tak ramai orang migrate ke sana. Orang migrate ke US only. So dia tak exposed. So that is too far for them to travel, right? So generally dia tak tahu Malaysia mana, dia tak tahu semua tu, right? So Muslim form, for all you know, I was the first Muslim they've ever met. So yeah, so those are the things. So bila dia tak pernah jumpa, dia tak boleh nak
lah.
Dia tak boleh nak ada that apa discrimination tu, dia pun tak tahu kan. So so discrimination ni is always start with media. The more media portray different things, the more they have this mindset, right?
Yeah, right.
But if you dah expose and everything, you takkan ada, insyaallah takkan ada discrimination ni. But like I said, you're a visitor kan, so you have to know that you are a visitor in that particular country. So in the end, you have to be polite lah.
Kental jugalah macam dekat sana, boleh sabar, kena discriminate macam tu.
Kena sabar banyak-banyak. You mana-mana pun. Mana-mana pun, you nowadays especially, you have to manage yourself, sabar banyak-banyak.
Would you go back to Chile, Mrs. Wani?
Definitely. I love Chile. Kalau ada, selalunya kita tak akan dipost again to that country. So but yeah, I would love to go back there again. I have a lot of friends there now. It's one of the, I travel quite a lot in for work and for leisure, and I would put Chile in my top 3.
Wow.
Yeah, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful country.
Top 1 apa ni?
Top 1 tu, it's actually I judge more cities than countries. Because sometimes you go to that particular city, right? So I would say number 1 now in my preferred city to live in is New York.
Ingat Argentina tadi.
But I'm a city girl. I'm a city girl, so I like cities. I like big cities. So yeah, I like
city girl tau. Girl, okay, girl.
City girl. Yes. Yeah. City girl.
Girl power, okay?
Okay, macam Miss cakap, Miss minat untuk city ni. Macam Hong Kong ni, saya ada buat research, dia cakap Hong Kong is high as compared to other countries in living cost. So macam mana Miss nak adapt dengan living cost dekat Hong Kong tu?
Okay, for your information, Hong Kong has always been in the top spots for cost of living surveys kan. I think this year there's this one index, Mercer, it's called Mercer cost of living survey. So Hong Kong somehow this year dia turun satu tempat ke nombor 2. So number 1 in the world now is Ashgabat, Turkmenistan. So because of rising because of the economic situation, you know, the cost of living to changes kan, like make things more expensive, right? So but still Hong Kong is still on the second spot. I think third I would say is Lebanon, Tokyo, Zurich, Shanghai, Singapore, Beijing and Bern, Switzerland. Those are top 10 countries paling mahal di dunia, right? So to give you an overview of the cost of living in Hong Kong. So I would like one bedroom apartment in Hong Kong, size about 100 square meter, would cost you about dalam 11,000 Hong Kong dollar, which is about 6,000 ringgit. In city Sanggar.
Oh my god, are you serious?
Alright. Room je kalau nak rent. Room tu apa? 40, maybe 50 square meter, less maybe 6,000 Hong Kong dollar, about 3,000 sebulan. Right?
Okay. Kos makan je ni.
So kalau you nak makan, in expensive lunch lah, beli-beli kat tepi jalan
that
shop.
Room apa? Tu ada toilet tak?
You selalu shared toilet. Kalau room tu is usually shared toilet. So oh. Kalau you nak, kalau dia ada toilet sendiri, selalu dia panggil studio. Alright. So studio tu yang macam saya cakap tadi lah, will cost you like minimum is RM6,000. In that expensive lunch in Hong Kong would cost you about roughly minimum 60 Hong Kong dollar, which is about RM30. Sekarang nasi ada sayur, ada ikan sikit je. Very basic, or maybe noodle, right? One bowl of noodle dapat itu je. So itu kalau you non-Muslim. Kalau you Muslim, tambah lagi 30%. You nak halal. Alright? Wow. So that will make my lunch is about minimum 80 to 100 Hong Kong dollar, which is about apa, 50 ringgit ke 110 ringgit per lunch. Alright? Just satu dish. Right, kita kat Malaysia satu dish you pergi gerai makan macam-macam baru
berapa
je kan?
RM2.
Hari-hari makan Maggi lah macam tu.
Maggi combo meal pun dah RM about nearly RM30 per combo meal Maggi. Mineral water RM4. And then Coke RM5. Kalau you nak pergi Starbucks, cost kat sini is among the highest in the world. So satu small cup of coffee ke caramel macchiato ke yang you suka tu, duduk semua tu kan, it will cost about dalam RM25. So which is high, you know. So itu kata you tak tambah-tambah lagi, right? You tak tambah-tambah lagi.
Add on, add on lagi.
Kecil je. Ya, kat Malaysia maybe you shop sendiri order grande, right? Grande.
So, masak sendiri boleh save cost ke? Misalnya?
Okay, masalahnya masak sendiri pun mahal. So, bagi contoh. Satu dozen eggs kat supermarket, harga dia dalam 12 biji, right? Harga dalam, depends on dari mana dia datang. So, kadang-kadang cost you RM16 ke RM30. Kalau dia US lain, China lain. Ada juga daripada Malaysia. I selalu daripada Malaysia. I selalu beli yang daripada Malaysia. Murah sikit. 20 lebih Hong Kong dollar je. Alright. Wow. Onion je. Onion 4 biji RM12. 4 biji besar RM12. Alright. Butter. I pun terperanjat kat sini. Butter RM40. 20 ke RM30. Butter.
Wow. So, Miss, kalau kita orang pergi sana, Miss, kita rasa macam mana? Kita patut masak sendiri ni, belilah.
Ramai Malaysians yang if they travel here, they try to cari Airbnb sebab boleh masak halal. Generally it's a bit hard to find halal food here, even though you kena tahu sebab it's scattered, right? You cannot like di bawah ada jumpa halal, right? Even though dah banyak lah sikit daripada as compared to before. But generally people will but ada juga lah kat sini yang restaurant or hotel yang halal certified, so that helps lah more now than before. Yeah.
Okay lah. Lagipun tu lah kat sana, Miss. Yelah, ramai yang daripada kami sendiri nak travel ke luar negara. Masing-masing ada lah minat rasa sama ada nak sambung belajar lepas tu kerja kat luar, contohnya sambung tourism kat sini, lepas tu nak sambung kat dalam negara, kat Cambridge ke sebagainya. So saya pasti Hong Kong mesti ada offer something ataupun experience untuk orang-orang Malaysia kat sana. Ada tak beza antara living and working kat Hong Kong dengan Malaysia? Sama je ke atau ada beza?
Well, generally ada beza dia lah, I would say.
Selain makanan,
I think based from the Malaysians who come
work
here.
Ethics lah, more like work ethics.
Definitely there's a difference. Malaysia ni kita relax sikit. All right.
Janji Melayu. So,
yes. Hong Kong ni is very, very rush. Eh? Dia nak tu, dia kena dapat tu. Because you kena faham, Hong Kong ni, every minute counts. So, sebab it's harga, it's duit to people, right? The more you delay, nak delay hantar barang, harga cost dah kena, harga cost warehouse kena. Timing pun kalau you nak apa, you charge orang, you know, the cost of charging people, you know, those kind of things. So, everything too high. It's all high. High salary, high rental, high transportation cost, services cost mahal. So benda ni dia nak cepat. So that work ethic tu dia always nak on time. So bila dia expect, so dalam a few days tu kita dah kena, or immediately kita kena respond. While in Malaysia ni, I notice, you know, people are more laid back, take time to do their job. You know, oh, I have ni, oh, especially COVID times. Oh, now I have to work from home. It's hard for me to get some things. You know, kat sini tak ada macam tu. So, yeah, so bila you nak pergi overseas tu, tengok culture, business ethic tu sendiri. Kalau if you rasa you tak boleh nak come up to that expectation, then a bit hard lah for you to survive in the business world tu. And kat sini you kena faham, everyone, semua cost of living mahal. So they really rely on they're really trying to improve their well-being, right? Kena kerja kuat-kuat, dapat gaji better. So kat sini a lot of backstabbing, right? Oh. So cepat je orang tu nak kacau tempat you, sebab opportunity tu kan, dia nak tunjuk dia lagi bagus daripada you. So kalau you tak perform, then what's the point of the employer ambil you kerja kat situ kan? So akan ada orang lain yang maybe lagi better than you, or tunjuk better than you.
That kawan-kawan miss yang macam, you know, dia tak boleh nak adapt, dia tak boleh nak cope, and apa jadi dia? Ada tak ada pengalaman miss?
Generally a lot of them cannot cope to the cost. Right? Malaysian ni somehow we have the impression of the Hong Kongers, kita ni flexible in doing our job. Alright? So kita, I think sebab in Malaysia also kita ni antara yang overwork country. Kita stay sampai lambat. So kat sini kita pun jadi orang sini tak ada nak work lambat punya. Dia on time. You know, datang buat kerja itu je job scope. That's the job scope. Tu je lah yang dia buat. Right? If you want more,
balik,
you pay more, you know? Oh. So generally Malaysia tu kita flexible, kita tak kisah nak kerja lambat. That's the overall impression, right? But dekat sini people, Malaysian generally tak boleh cope on the cost. Right? It's in the end, it's always the cost. So because kalau you tak when you let's say you are offered to work working in Hong Kong, you have to know that the cost of living too is very high. So when they offer you a job, you have to make sure that offer to kena cover all these things. Kalau tidak, it's not worth it. Because everything is expensive. Yeah.
Miss, saya, based on your experience, you dah move to Chile, move to Hong Kong, and saya ada opinion yang kalau working abroad ni, dia membuatkan someone tu tak ada masa untuk settle downkan diri dia. Contohnya kat Malaysia, you can buy your house, you can have apa, family time. So macam miss working abroad, miss ada tak pernah terasa macam nak unsettle, tak pernah terasa unsettle while you are working abroad?
Okay, of course if you work abroad ni, you are always far away from your family and friends, right? Your friends who you have grown up together, your kawan-kawan kawan-kawan yang study maybe sama-sama. So bila you tinggalkan Malaysia, you don't get to feel that you lepak-lepak sama-sama diorang dekat mamak dulu, you know. You jumpa your parents especially, you nak jumpa diorang senang je kan. Nak pergi, kalau you tinggal kat KL macam my parents, they live in Shah Alam. So it's easy for me je, pergi je Shah Alam, dah jumpa dah, right? Here, especially in Chile, it was harder because I wasn't able to go back as easily because Chile is very far. So I think throughout my four years kat Chile, I only managed to go back twice. In Hong Kong, I try to go back once or twice a year. So, but currently, I haven't been back for 2 years. So because of COVID. So yeah, I mean you will still have that rasa unsettled sebab because unless you are working in that country for a long time, maybe you dah jadikan you you dah duduk kat situ, so everything will jadi permanent kan, you dah rootkan your life kat situ. Tapi if your work entails you to be posted to different country every time, so you will have this anxiety, right? So you know, you only live a certain period of time, lepas tu you kena pindah. So it's always that nak pindah, you kena fikir tu semua, right? So yeah, it's hard lah. Because, and like for me, you know, being single is hard because you have to maintain that relationship, right? But it's hard to maintain that relationship when you constantly move around, right? And I don't believe in long distance. I don't believe in long distance relationship.
For me,
you kena tanya diri you sendiri.
Kalau pernah tanya diri you sendiri.
Kalau you tak kisah dia nak call you kan, you pun suka call dia, by all means long distance. Tapi if you rasa you pemalas nak call, you pemalas nak balik
kena ada depan
dia,
mata.
That's not for you, right? So,
I mean,
so yeah.
Benda tu dia orang lah.
Yeah, so orang. So like I said, and then you know, I single. So bayangkan orang yang dah ada anak, yeah, dah ada family. You have to think about sekolah anak-anak lagi. Hmm. You know, anak-anak tu nak membesar macam mana, kan? So ada yang a few of my Muslim friends have trouble raising their kids overseas in a Muslim. Background kan, anak macam ni nak raise anak-anak betul-betul secara Islam, tapi you duduk di negara yang tak ramai orang Islam, so they have a hard time. Sebab anak-anak pun kadang-kadang tanya, why can't we have a dog, you know? Ha, you nak jawab apa?
Mesti dia tengok kawan lah.
Lagi sekarang ni pula LGBT kan, the community is getting bigger. So as a Muslim, kita ada kita punya limitations, right? We have to be open, but we ada limitation kita. Macam mana nak terangkan ke anak-anak you nanti? This lifestyle tu boleh ke, tak boleh ke? You know, how to be open about it? Living in a foreign land, you have to be open, kan? Sebab those are their cultures, right? So you have to be open. Macam mana nak ajar anak you to open, but at the same time, grounded in their religious background? So it's hard. So I thank God I tak ada anak. I respect those people who live abroad. Being a Muslim, ada anak. Yeah, it's hard.
So kalau kerja macam Miss ni, I think it's better to stay single lah. Sebab betul lah, susah kan nak jaga anak, nak raise them semua tu.
My basic advice is if you want to work abroad, kalau boleh buat masa tengah single.
Betul, and then
pada commitment lagi tau.
Betul
true.
So Miss, I know that you have been working abroad for a long time. Macam tadi Miss cakap dah almost 9 years kan. And kalau macam saya ni, saya cepat homesick. Even masa duduk dekat UiTM Melaka pun tiap minggu homesick. So, saya jarang boleh balik, apatah lagi madam yang duduk kat Hong Kong kan. So macam mana madam pernah tak rasa homesick ke, nangis nak balik Malaysia ke?
Nangis eh?
And sebab siapa je tak nangis sebab homesick kan?
Betul. Fatin banyak nangis.
Setiap hari.
Why mata ni?
Dalam
Malaysia. Malaysia pun dah kan, tak dapat balik raya pun dah nangis kan. Ni dah 9 tahun ni tak raya Malaysia. So apa, yeah, I mean this July 9 tahun abroad. Of course I miss my family and friends the most. Itu yang I would say every day, right? Constant thoughts that okay ke mak bapak kita kat kampung, you know. Even though kita ada beradik semua, bila kita jauh ni, kita bukannya, walaupun Hong Kong alhamdulillah dekat sikit dengan Malaysia, but still, you know, kalau jadi apa-apa kan, boleh tak kita balik on time? Kalau je, paling I risau dulu masa I kat Chile, sebab nak balik Malaysia pun will take me 2 days. So I pray to God, you know, jangan jadi apa-apa dekat family. In Hong Kong alhamdulillah nak balik less than 4 hours, so cepat sikit, right? So but still, you know, you always pray to God that tak ada kawan-kawan family or kawan-kawan baik jadi apa-apa kat dorang yang membuatkan kita yang jauh ni susah kita nak tengok kan semua, right? So I think Second thing, I would say makanan lah. I would say tak sama.
Makanan. Nombor satu.
Melayu kan?
Sekarang musim durian pula tu.
Banyak mana pun availability of Malaysian food, especially in Hong Kong, is much more. It's not the same as Malaysia. You know, paling you miss is your mom's cooking, right? So itu yang I paling ni. In Chile dulu, lagi lah. You know, it's hard to find Asian food, right? Kalau ada pun Thai, you know, Thai food. But it's still not the same taste. You nak buat makanan sendiri pun, it's hard because you tak ada, kan? I think sepanjang 4 tahun tinggal di Chile, 2 kali je I dapat kunyit hidup. Right?
Wow.
I jumpa kunyit hidup.
You cannot grow that?
Well, I'm not a gardener like you. I don't have a green thumb, so I never attempted to grow anything. But yeah, it's hard, you know. So just imagine, right? So and then halal food lagi susah dulu dekat Chile, right? So it's hard. But in Hong Kong, it's better. So you kind of like, I feel like going back home. So East Asia, you dapat makanan Asian banyak lagi. Malaysian restaurant pun banyak. But it's still not the same, you know. So, lupa tu, bila Ramadan lah, antara yang you miss the most, kan? Because Ramadan, you makan sama-sama dengan your family. Buka puasa, you pergi bazar Ramadan. Senang je. Pergi bazar Ramadan, tunjuk. Dah dapat, right? Kat sini, you teringat je, habis dah. Teringat je Ramadan, you nak. So, you have to do it. You have to make yourself. Tu lah datang. Teringin apam balik, buat sendiri apam balik. Teringin buat kuih apa-apa kuih lah, kena buat. Teringin I'm a Johorian, teringin laksa Johor, buat laksa Johor. So you have to lah, kan? So yeah, that's the hard part lah of basically the homesick feeling that you get, right, when you live abroad. So but luckily lah kat sini ramai Malaysian and ramai restaurant Malaysian, so that makes up a bit lah of that homesickness, kan.
Ada buat majlis ke kat sana? Bila time raya, ada buat majlis ke macam-macam?
Ada. Dekat consulate lah. Selalu kita tak jemput ramai-ramai. Consulate tak jemput ramai-ramai. So, dia jemput mainly bulan puasa. Kita ada buat solat terawih. Kita buat buka puasa. Dan raya tu, kita ada buat lah majlis sikit untuk celebrate. Adalah.
Macam ni cakap, macam makanan lain-lain. So, sana mesti culture lain. So, sebagai seorang yang kerja di luar negara, culture shock ni mesti tak pernah lari dari miss. So as example, Chile dengan Hong Kong, dia punya environment lain. The way the people see you lain juga, kan?
Yeah.
So how long do you take to get comfortable with the culture? And apa yang paling menarik tentang culture yang lain ni, miss?
In the end, I think in the end, it is this is when you start testing your adapting skills, right? Alright. Alhamdulillah, I've been traveling to 35 countries so far, and living in two continents for work and leisure. So I always remind myself that I'm the visitor, macam saya cakap tadi, kan? So I'm the visitor, and you can't simply do a lot of things that you generally do back home, right? Okay, So you kena always be sensitive lah to the local cultures and the religious sensitivities, right? So itu antara, I would say, like if you want to work abroad or even traveling, at least you have to understand that you tak boleh buat sesuka hati you, right? You have to respect people. So so you have to If you're introvert also, it's hard, kan? So because you especially if you go to a country, you tak kenal siapa-siapa. So takkan you nak duduk kat rumah je, tak buat apa-apa, right? Because you have to adapt. You have to live, right? So it's good to make friends with locals. That's the most important thing. Make friends with local. And if you know of any Malaysian, first and foremost, selalu kita advise lah, pergi consulate. Perkara pertama, kalau you tak tahu siapa-siapa, pergi consulate dulu. Jumpa orang consulate. At least you dah ada Malaysian dah dekat si consulate or embassy. Jumpa
at
orang.
At least,
orang
boleh bagi tahu.
Yeah, at least ada orang Malaysian kat situ yang boleh tolong you. You pun boleh register yourself in the embassy. So at least get to know. And then from there, sometimes dia kenal orang ni, dia kenal orang ni, dia kenal Malaysian kat situ. So you dah expand your network kan. But at same time, and then when you are working, you dah, your professional network tu akan berkembang juga. So all the more you dah get comfortable kan in that particular country. So I would say it will take around 1 year lah kot for you to be really familiar with your environment.
Apa kerja yang macam Miss, macam bila Miss tengok kat Hong Kong tu macam, eh, Mat, tak boleh brainnya kedua orang macam ni, macam tak boleh terima, macam sangat berbeza kan.
Kalau Miss boleh share pengalaman Miss
In Hong Kong, I would say like generally macam saya cakap tadi, orang Hong Kong ni dia nak cepat saja kan. So at the point of nak cepat tu, dia dah jadi rude. Right? So the way the orang Hong Kong ni dia cakap pun very kasar tau, kasar. So bila dia cakap kat you tu, kadang macam memang sound, bila you nak taxi ke, you nak pergi restoran, order makanan, the way dia cakap kat you macam dia marah you tau. So kita macam, I dah 5 tahun dekat sini kan, I memang feel I cannot macam, hal kan, you know. Dah marah aku macam,
tiba-tiba nak marah.
So kadang-kadang kita cakap baik-baik. So sekarang, so that is the thing that I still don't understand, but at the same time, you try to understand lah. Sebab you tahu, living in Hong Kong is hard. It's hard for the locals here. Right? So, dia nak cepat.
Ini macam duduk di Melaka tu, Mrs. Wan.
Dah, mungkin lah kot. Tapi dia tak keluar lah ambau je. Kan?
Awal.
So, yeah, they constantly nak cepat, cakap apa. So, kita pun dah jadi macam, kita pun terpaksa be rude to them. Baru, sebab kita dah tak boleh cakap proper. Yeah, so itu yang still in a way I have, I'm not really adjust fully. Tapi I kena faham lah, right? Yeah, so but in Chile dulu it was hard, the language itself was hard, generally other things is like quite normal. It's quite normal. You just, the more people you know, the more language you speak, it makes your life easier. Yeah.
Sesuatu saya wondering lah, Miss kan banyak berurusan dengan orang kan. Lagipun sekarang ni, macam kita tahulah pandemik dah daripada March 2020 dah pada sekarang.
Ya.
Yeah. Dah banyak kesan dah pada negara. Itu kan kalau tengok Malaysia pun, kes hari ni, semalam 6 kes, kemarin pun 6 kes, naik turun. Kalau boleh share tentang Hong Kong punya pandemik macam mana. And also, okay, kami pun agak terkejut lah sebab yang working abroad ni kebanyakan ni dah kena force, hantar balik ke negara sendiri. To do some employment condition lah. Jadi ada tak career, kes pandemic ni affect your career? Alright. Ada tak berkesan?
So I mean, I think COVID started early 2020, right? So in Hong Kong, in Hong Kong in total kita ada 4 wave, right? So four wave. So it started in February 2020 and on off until June this year, right? So but alhamdulillah Hong Kong never go more than 150 cases per day, right? So dia alhamdulillah dia dapat contain in that sense lah, kawalan infection tu di community, among the community. But you kena faham, Hong Kong ni dulu pernah ada SARS, a lot of people mati. So dia dah tahu macam mana. So generally with pre-COVID also, Hong Kong ni dia orang-orang dia very disciplined, right? Bila nak batuk dia cover, kalau sakit pakai mask. Every building you pergi dah memang disinfect. So you ada rasa that safety in that sense, right? So bila COVID ni lagi dia orang risau because Hong Kong is a very densely populated city. Di dalam city ni kita ada 7.5 million people dalam a land that sebesar Johor, if not mistaken, right? So dia kena, kalau satu building kena, it can affect a lot of people. So dia Hong Kong is among the strictest country untuk jaga COVID ni. So sekarang border still close. Alhamdulillah kita sekarang tak ada local cases. And only imported cases, because they are still opening up resident untuk balik Hong Kong. So only resident yang can enter Hong Kong. So kita ada imported cases, but on average imported about 2 to 3 cases per day. That's about it. So generally Hong Kong has never been on lockdown. Dia only encourage people to work from home. Business are still normal. Cuma macam lifestyle businesses tu, karaoke, gym, tempat-tempat makan, itu on and off dia tutup, right? And then social distancing tu wajib pakai mask, duduk di restoran duduk 4 orang saja, you know. So generally we can still go out and about. So kita tak ada macam Malaysia, kita terpaksa duduk rumah saja. So but work from home tu, I would say dalam ada 4 kali I work from home just to be safe, kan, ourselves, kan. You have to be disciplined yourself lah. But otherwise, the hard part is business lah, because banyak tak boleh meeting orang. So there's a lot of Zoom meetings, event tak ada. So yeah, so, and of course, many Malaysians I know here and here in Hong Kong and Macau are affected, you know, because businesses are not doing well. Sebab Hong Kong and Macau ni, they are rely on tourists, kan. So China tourists. So bila turis tak boleh masuk, it affects the business. So banyak businesses tutup. Hotel pun tak ramai orang datang. So they had to lay off some people. So when they lay off some people, orang pertama yang kena are foreigners, right? So a lot of Malaysian di Hong Kong dan Macau ada yang kena dihantar balik. Sebab basically employer dah tak mampu, right? Because not doing business. And then I know a lot of people also yang kena cut, pay cut, right? Kalau company tu tak nak tutup, they still wanna hire, dia pay cut ataupun dia force leave, right? Unpaid leave. Yeah, those are the general things that they do. But personally for me, I would say mentally lah, I would say, right? I was supposed to go back to Malaysia last year, July 2020. So I've been extended for 3 times already. So dah 1.5 year extended. So so bila dah unsure tu kan, uncertainty tu membuatkan kena pindah ke tak ni, kena pindah ke tak ni, kan. So I get anxiety because of not knowing bila nak kena balik ni. Yeah, so that's the general issue that people face. Not just of that, yeah, those who are directly affected, but mentally also definitely. Duit tak ada, kan, gaji kena potong. So it's hard, it's really hard for the ones makan gaji kat luar tu.
Macam ni sendiri kan, Miss, as in your position, kalau work from home tu ada rasa terbeban tak? Ada rasa macam
macam kita ni tak? Kita belajar daripada rumah pun ada rasa berbeza, kan?
Generally for me personally, especially in a work where you need to meet a lot of people, alright? So when you need to meet a lot of people, that's your KPI for work. It's hard, right? So because you can't go out, people pun don't want to go out. So whenever we ask for physical meetings, they tak nak. So it's hard to really get to know the people, right? So Zoom saja, it doesn't convey the same thing as face to face. So but we have to make do lah, because that's the norm now, right? You have to face it, and so in our work we have to adapt lah, you know. We have to adapt, we have to do online meetings. In the future also, if tak ada COVID pun, I still think that this online meeting are still going to continue, because it's cost saving, right? So it's cost saving. People technically don't have to travel, don't have to spend money to travel. So that in a way is good for the company. So yeah, I mean, there are changes, but at the same time, it's still hard, because especially in a business that requires you to have a face-to-face interaction, right? It's hard for them. Yeah.
Okay, Miss, soalan famous yang selalu kita sebut-sebut sekarang, kan, sentiasa ada dalam conversation, are you vaccinated?
Am I what?
Vaccinated.
I'm fully vaccinated since April.
Oh wow, awal.
Yeah. So in Hong Kong, In Hong Kong, dia dah offer free vaccination for all residents since February. Kita boleh choose mana kita nak. So far, dia only offer Pfizer dengan Sinovac. Yeah.
So Malaysia belum lagi.
Malaysia belum lagi.
Is everyone in Hong Kong vaccinated or they are still in progress?
Still in progress because kat Hong Kong ni dia punya local take up for vaccination is not that high, right? So sampai di tahap sekarang where the government and private companies are offering incentive for their staff to get vaccinated. So sekarang di Hong Kong kita ada lucky draw, menang rumah. Wow. Menang voucher shopping. Dapat credit card punya budget offered by company. So siapa fully vaccinated, dia boleh masuk into the raffle, lucky draw untuk dia orang menang.
Oh, kreatif so, cara dia nak suruh orang
sampai macam tu sekali.
Sampai berebut-rebut ni.
Tu sini kena berebut-rebut.
Pasti berebut-rebut. Pasti current vaccination rate is 20% only kat Hong Kong.
Oh. And you have to do it twice lah ke only once?
Twice because twice. As far as we know, only Johnson and Johnson only yang satu kali vaccinated. Vaccination, yang lain semua kena dua kali.
Oh, okay. So kita move on to subject pandemic ni sangat very serious. So kita kita akan bincangkan tentang yang lebih relax sikit.
Okay.
So bila kita dekat abroad ni, we tend to associate with people daripada home country kita sendiri. So kita tend to do more gathering, kita akan celebrate cultural event. Macam Miss tadi pun ada sambut hari raya sama-sama.
Yes. Kan?
Sebab lepas rindu, bila lagi nak cakap bahasa Melayu ke, mana dah tahu kan.
Yes.
So macam mana Miss boleh keep yourself in touch with Malaysian friend? Macam ni Miss Madam Azwi ni kan? Macam mana?
Oh, well, Malaysian friends. Malaysian friends.
Well,
kita ada special group, okay.
Group.
Yeah. So, personally, if for our friends in Malaysia, right, when you live abroad, you have to make an effort lah to keep in touch with your friends back home. Masing-masing busy, masing-masing ada kerja, right, ada family and everything. So, if you takde make an effort, then it will be hard lah. So I have my issues also sometimes, you know, I guilty of not keeping in touch with some as well, while ada juga yang I still keep in touch, you know. So from time to time tu you kena lah juga reach out to them and ask them, right? Especially macam your close friends tu, for sure you akan ada chat group, you can talk to them. But those yang tak jarang jumpa tu maybe sekali-sekala je you jumpa, right? Because you when I balik Malaysia also, it's hard for me to jumpa everyone. So because I have only 1 or 2 week je apa time kan bila balik Malaysia, so I cannot meet everyone. So yeah, you still have to make an effort lah. Kalau tak ada effort tu memang tak jadi lah. But kalau in Hong Kong, here in Hong Kong, kita ramai Malaysian. We have about 20,000 Malaysians here in Hong Kong. So kita ada Malaysian Association. Organizations such as Malaysian Association, we have Malaysian Chamber of Commerce. So that helps us get to know a lot of Malaysians here in Hong Kong. And Malaysian pun generally kita punya sentiment sesama Malaysian ni kita suka tolong. We are friendly. Kita tolong sesama Malaysian. So that helps lah for me to adapt to the life here. Sebab ramai orang tolong. But in terms of getting in touch tu, either dekat or jauh, you have to make an effort lah.
Betul.
Macam Miss, kalau hari raya kat sana meriah. Macam ramai kawan Malaysia kat sana kan. Diorang raya.
Macam mana situation hari raya kat sana? Dapat ke lemang?
Lemang sekarang kita dah ada instant. So dah tak ada isu dah. Nona ada instant lemang. So no worries about that.
But instant lemang generally, daripada Malaysia ke?
Ya, daripada Malaysia. Memang lemang daripada Malaysia. So but ada of course yang rajin buat sendiri, right? So you you make your own lemang guna cups lah, guna
apa? Ada.
Yeah. So there's a lot of ways that memang dah lama orang create tu. So but in Hong Kong sebab kita ada banyak Malaysian, so kita still can do a lot of things, right? So so in terms of kemeriahan tu, last year was not that meriah because the COVID was still high. So kita orang pergi just rumah kawan seorang je, that's it, satu hari je raya. So this year was a bit more festive. So kita ada buat di consulate, lepas tu ada kawan seorang lagi buat kat rumah dia, and then ada buat lagi kat rumah dia. So we were able to visit people's house. But generally, dua hari je lah kita raya, kita tak buat lebih daripada tu. So in overseas ni, dia punya raya feeling ni is not as high as in Malaysia lah. Sebab kita pun tak, kita jauh daripada family kan. Sometimes it's hard for us to go back during hari raya. So so we have to make do with whatever opportunity that we can get. So kalau orang buat kita pergi, kalau orang tak buat kita life as usual lah.
Macam raya kat situ, kat Hong Kong meriah, kalau kat Chile tu macam mana?
Chile kita satu hari je raya, itu pun dekat consulate saja. That's about it. Chile lagi tak ada feel. tak ada feel. Nak buat masak pun is hard, ingredients tak ada, right? So in the end, buat sikit-sikit apa yang boleh and just one day celebrate, that's it. Lepas tu dah tak ada apa-apa dah. Yeah.
So, move on to the next question. Ni soalan ni sangat antara members kami selalu tertanya-tanya. After many years living in one place, kita get used to the way things are, and some people even find a way to remain abroad. So in your case, any plan to continue working abroad or kata okay, I have enough, so I want to return home, nak balik ke tanah air to, you know, kerja sini pula ke?
For me, as long as I work in my trade, I will have that opportunity to work abroad because the job entails us to go out, right? So tengok masing-masing punya situation at that point in time. Kadang availability of officers tu, kita every year ada je bertukar orang. So like I said, I'm supposed to go back, akan ada orang akan ganti I di sini. So kita akan sentiasa ada that opportunity. But but who knows, right? In the future, kalau I tak work in my trade,
in my trade.
Sorry, it's okay.
Right.
Which country
that option is open?
Which country do you actually, you know, like hope that you probably going to experience next if you get a chance?
It's hard to say because in my trade kita tak boleh pilih.
Oh. Yes. Ooh, tapi kalau diberi pilihan, kalau diberi pilihan,
I want Eastern Europe.
Oh, nice.
Makin jauh ya, makin jauh.
Sebab kenapa Europe?
Because I noticed, because I've experienced Chile, and not experienced Hong Kong. Okay, because I have experienced living in South America, yang negara yang it's not easy for you to go, right? And then you have another in Hong Kong yang you boleh datang tiap-tiap tahun, right? So work wise too, I like working where each country tu lain-lain dia punya apa, dia punya experience, right? Dia punya challenges also lain. So I like, but I notice that I like working where, I like being in a place where it's a bit challenging, right? So where orang tak tahu Malaysia. So I have to do that extra things that I have to educate people about Malaysia.
And then promote Malaysia juga, kan?
Promote Malaysia, promote barang-barang Malaysia, right? Yeah. So in a way, at the same time, walaupun susah in that part sebab dia tak kenal kita, but senang sebab kita directly can talk about Malaysia, right? Sebab dia tak ada idea about Malaysia, right? So but in Hong Kong, di negara developed countries ni, dia ada preconceived opinion about Malaysia. baik ke buruk tu dia dah ada. So bila you nak promote sesuatu benda tu, dia ada tahu yang baik about Malaysia, dia ada tahu yang tak baik about Malaysia. Right? Yeah, so that's a bit hard lah in that sense when you want to do certain job. So but I like that challenge of being in a place that nobody knows about Malaysia.
Macam Miss kan, Miss kan seorang woman, Miss tak ada rasa macam afraid or takut ke?
Macam mana?
Miss kan seorang. Miss tak ada rasa macam takut ke bila setiap kali Miss travel anything related to crime ke apa ke?
Okay. Safety wise, in Hong Kong, alhamdulillah, because you tak ada, generally Hong Kong is a very safe country. I keluar malam-malam ke apa pun dia memang tak ada issue. Naik taxi ke pergi mana-mana memang tak ada issue. In Chile dulu ada issue sikit sebab certain areas in South America memang unsafe, but you akan kena rob or anything like everything like that. So you have to be careful lah apa you pakai, you kena downscale sikit. So you can't really show barang-barang jam ke apa benda bag ke kan. So yeah, you have to be you kena be aware lah of your surrounding.
I think we are towards the end kan, kita nak buka Q&A dah kan.
Before we end to Q&A session, we have one last question. Okay, Miss, after listening to your experience kan, Miss, banyak experience Miss, and got me excited lah to feel macam mana experience pergi bekerja ke luar negara ni. And I believe even the participants pun rasa apa yang saya rasa. So Miss, can you give us like your best advice lah for us yang still student ni, yang ada minat to work and also living abroad?
Alright, so for my advice from my advice is that do it while you are single, right? you have the family, it will cost more, it'll be hard to move around families, right? Okay, so and then you have to know your own capabilities or skills yang you ada. Like I said before, not everyone can work abroad, you know, especially if you don't have that special set of skills. So you have to know what makes you better than the locals in that country. What can you offer more than the locals in that country, right? Then thirdly, you have to do your due diligence on that country you're going to, right? Salary tu enough ke nak cover your expenses living there? If not enough, then it's not worth it, right? So are you the lifestyle or culture there easy ke tak for you to adapt? Kalau you tak berani nak change certain things, it's not for you to work abroad, right? Then be realistic. So a lot of people nak go abroad sebab dia ingatkan kita dapat high salary, konon-konon you have to you can live that high end expat life, right? Generally people nak work abroad because of those two reasons, right? But many people tak realise that living overseas ni your quality of life tu akan menurun, right?
Oh yeah.
It depends on the country that you go to, right? So it's because life in a foreign country is hard for foreigners, right? In some countries, foreigners are regarded as second class citizen, right? So you have to ask yourself, are you willing to be away from your families and friends for years? So are you willing to give up your luxuries in Malaysia, right? Are you willing to work harder than normally you would have to in Malaysia to show your employer dekat that particular country tu that you are worth their investment? If you say yes to all those questions, by all means, apply a job overseas. But if you say no to those questions, stay in Malaysia. Yeah? Bukan tak galakkan, but it's hard. It's hard. Life abroad is hard. You tak ada kawan-kawan, you tak ada family nak you turn to. Right? You sorang-sorang dekat abroad. So if you tak ready, I tak advise. Right? I see a lot of people here struggling. Nak makan pun tak ada keluar-keluar. Yeah, dia tak keluar pun ke Hong Kong ni nak makan abroad. So it's hard for them. So do you want that quality of life? So if you are okay to live like that, by all means. But if you're not willing, you nak kena simpan je duit, tak enjoy that country, then it's not worth it.
Betul tu ni, sebab itulah advice yang saya paling nampak sekarang ni, yang pasal middle, Amir sebut pasal secondary class tu. Kena jaga attire, the way we talk tu.
Yes.
Ada. Kalau betul, tak jaga benda tu memang habis lah. Orang buat pun pandang rendah juga kan.
True, true.
Kita act as small embassy juga, ambassador. Kita act as yes, small
course.
Ambassador.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's not for everyone, but I'm sure everyone can try. But if you want to attempt, you can attempt, you know, but at a risk lah.
Yeah,
yes.
But if you can do it, soalan ni.
Yeah, but if you can do it, by all means, go abroad, try yourself. But you kena ingat, Malaysia pun perlu talents di Malaysia. Right? Kita kekurangan talents di Malaysia. So kita ada macam-macam program to encourage expat overseas nak datang kat Malaysia kerja. Kita encourage Malaysian overseas untuk balik Malaysia bekerja. So kita perlu. So kalau boleh tu, berkhidmat untuk negara dulu. Then maybe apa-apa pun, as a fresh graduate, I suggest kerja di Malaysia dulu. Alright? Kerja di Malaysia dulu, dapatkan experiences dan skills di Malaysia tu, so that you can set yourself apart from people in that particular country. So maknanya you ada juga experiences. Kalau you datang fresh, unless you're already studying abroad, itu another story. Tapi kalau you datang freshly ni, it's a bit hard lah kalau you tak ada that special skill sets. Right?
So we have that's the end of this session. We are going to move on to our next session is Q&A. Mm-hmm. So anyone from the audience who have
ramai tu dekat chat box tu.
Okay. All any right. Questions?
Yeah, question from the floor, guys.
Saya ada question tapi dia like general je. Assalamualaikum Miss. My name is Muhammad Iqbal. Tadi Miss ada mention lah yang Chile people tu dia nicer compared to Hong Kong. Lepas tu I tengok pun dekat Chile tu banyak tempat yang menarik, like ada apa Easter Island, Santiago, Chile Cultural Capital and many more. Lepas tu I nak tanya lah, have you ever thought maybe nak permanently stay dekat sana? Dia punya thought tu ada tak cross your mind?
Masa I live in Chile tu, I would say like I ada that thought, you know, because you already there kan, so you love the city so much, you love the country so much and the people, so you kind of have that okay, I don't mind living here for a long time, but then again reality come back to you and then you sedar diri kan, oh my god, I ada hutang dekat Malaysia yang I kena settle, so ada family back home that I have to take care of. So you kind of like, but of course lah, I mean everywhere you go to, in any city that you go, mesti ada satu or dua city yang really you rasa kena dengan jiwa you, right? Yeah. So yeah, but if ada opportunity tu, like I said, I don't mind going to the countries that I love. But like I say lah, because I'm still working with Matre, right? So I still have that long service that I have to do and also responsibilities that I have to be aware of, that I cannot simply just change, right? Your life like that. But yeah, I like working in Matre because of this opportunities that I get, right? Without being in a country for too long, but I get to be 4-5 tahun in certain cities. So I like that as well. So that gives me a bit of that of what I want in by working with Matre. So yeah, I mean, for now, I don't plan ahead much in my life, but so far, I like working with Matre.
Thank you, Miss.
All right, thanks, Bal.
All right, Miss. Ada soalan. Dia tanya, kalau nak work abroad ni, dia tengok skill je ke? Atau kalau macam mana kalau kita ni study dekat Malaysia, susah tak nak dapat kerja luar? Ataupun dia akan bandingkan universiti kat Malaysia dengan universiti kat USA. Orang ni lagi akan dapat kerja berbanding tu. Ataupun dia tengok skill.
Ya, yeah, generally di Hong Kong ni dia memandang tinggi kepada apa qualification di US dan UK, right? Ah. So because a lot of the locals here, they send their children abroad, UK mainly, right? Mm. So eventually, in that sense, when their children are about to enter university, so mostly dia akan hantar anak-anak dia orang dekat US or UK. Right, so of course the middle class, they are still belajar di Hong Kong. I would say ranking of universities di Hong Kong ada a few yang lagi tinggi daripada Malaysia. I think our ranking Malaysia UM yang paling tinggi sekarang, right? So in that sense too, ranking ni memainkan peranan. Ranking university memainkan peranan, right? So bila certain employers tu, in the end I would say, as an employer myself, mana you belajar dan di mana you belajar tu tak memainkan peranan pun. In the end you tengok people, I recruit people as well, previously you, in the end you tengok orang ada degree ke, at least meet your minimum requirement. Hmm. But other than that, you don't really look at where they study, right? Because you want, I look at in the end your experiences, right? So if dia belajar tinggi macam mana pun, tapi dia tak ada experiences yang sesuai dengan job yang dia minta tu, so then what's the point also, right? So yeah, so in the end it's good to have work experiences, and like I said, maybe some people don't have work experiences, especially like for graduates or student, right? So that it's important for you during your study days, you do a lot of practical work. Hmm. Right? So I think I remember dulu masa I di UiTM, I think Awin also can concur with me that we did a lot of events dulu, kita buat macam-macam.
Which UiTM mana?
Insya'alam.
Ah, okay.
Buat Insya'alam. So we did a lot of events. I think we participate in some events. Kita tolong buat events tu. And we did our own events ourselves. Dulu-dulu, it's not that big, but we did it, right? So actually, for graduates, when you have that, and then and your place of training also, right? Apa dia panggil sekarang? Your internship tu is important also, kan? Kalau especially you have macam ada certain area you nak pursue your career after studying, so memainkan peranan juga. So because that internship to give you that experience, that working experience that an employer can look at, right? Because studying too is very much book related, or maybe you know you learn from your lecturer who have experiences as well. But in the end, is that practical experience too yang penting juga, right? Book smart and street smart. So you kena ada dua-dua untuk you apply everything together, right?
Right.
So yeah, you have to kalau boleh, selagi boleh, try to be exposed to certain things that can improve your skills.
Okay. Thank you.
Right.
Like hosting PD Talk series.
Yes, like hosting. Yeah, this is among the skills that you can learn. You know, your communication skills, the way you talk to a speaker that you've never met before, you know, and maybe for me, I'm quite friendly, right? Ada maybe speaker yang is a bit hard, right? Yeah, yang very yang very apa introvert, serious. Hanya satu jawab satu. Yeah, then the main task is for the host to tarik, keluarkan jawapan-jawapan tu daripada speaker. So that is in itself a skill that you can learn. So but of course, if because of the current situation, you can't be physical in doing things, right? So I in the end, post COVID, inshallah, you try to expose yourself, you know. Ask your lecturer Azwin untuk buat, you know, seminar, betul-betul punya seminar, right? Because tourism ni, I remember because what made me interested in events was during my DTM days, my tourism days. So I was not into travel agent or hotel, I was into events. I was interested in the event side of it. I like managing the events. So hence, that was my career path. But macam mana dia termasuk ke matrik, because in the end, matrik dulu banyak event. Kita banyak event. So I was interested of matrik because matrik banyak event. I was never thinking about pergi abroad pun, kan? Tapi bila dah masuk matrik, macam-macam lah pula ada. Right? So in the end, it has brought me to where I am today. And I'm still doing events. I'm still doing exporters development. I'm still doing international trade advisory. I still do a lot. So yeah, all those experiences helped me a lot lah in doing what I do today.
Alright.
Is there any question from the audience? Ada lagi ke nak tanya?
Okay, tak ada lagi.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Dengar. Hello, my name is Masarina, and hello, Miss Ezzwanee, Madam Queen, and all the team members. So I have this one question. Like, there's a debate about working abroad, where here in Malaysia, we know that Malaysia is like highly brain drained. And I don't want to sound like makcik bawang, but there are people who say that hantar and bayar mahal-mahal pergi belajar dekat luar, tapi end up bekerja dekat sana instead of coming back to serve in your own country. Like you mentioned earlier about serving your own country and so on. So yeah, what is your opinion on that statement?
Okay, first of all, macam I cakap tadi, one of the reason why people go abroad is because dia dah belajar di overseas, right? Itu satu. So itu you tak boleh control a bit because they are already overseas, and generally offer to work abroad comes from within near their universities, right? In their particular city or country. So organically people akan straight away accept that offer, right? Okay, another thing, orang yang di Malaysia keluar ke luar negara. So generally I think historically there was a time in tahun 70-80 ada economic boom in certain countries, right? So opportunity tu lagi bagus di certain di negara berkenaan berbanding dengan negara sendiri, right? So tak kira lah either Malaysia pergi overseas or overseas pergi Malaysia ke apa ke. So it's the same. So generally people migrated back in the 70s, 80s, I would say so, right? So generally people pergi ke sana ke sini because of that economic boom in certain countries. Contohnya, a lot of Malaysian datang di Hong Kong ni masa tahun 70-80s. Sebab Hong Kong masa tu tengah naik. Dia tengah naik. So opportunity tu lagi bagus, right? So then I believe I juga ada buat research, and ada one leading global staffing and recruitment company, dia ada buat survey 2019. Dia kata 9 out of 10 Malaysian, which is 90% of Malaysian, will settle and work abroad for better career opportunities and work-life balance, right? Yeah. So among the preferred countries, dia kata Australia, Singapore, Japan. Why? Kenapa orang nak pergi overseas? Sebab they perceive that particular country tu able to provide higher salaries and support healthier work-life balances. And also market to have better exchange rate, better taxation, those kind of things, right? So in the end, macam berbalik kepada jawapan I tadi, kan? Ekonomi negara masing-masing tu, it's hard for you to compare satu negara ke negara yang lain sebab negara tu di tahap yang berbeza-beza, right? How can you compare Malaysia and with certain negara yang dah develop, kan? Yang bertahun-tahun dah develop, yang dia punya income lagi higher, right? So dia punya companies pun besar-besar. So it's hard for you to really compare. But like I said, in the end it goes back to choices of the people, right? So you cannot halang people. Tapi I believe di Malaysia sekarang kita aspire to be a developed nation. So bila kita aspire to be a developed nation, kita akan ada banyak rapid development dekat Malaysia, right? So with a lot of rapid development in trade and investment, kita perlukan the right talent to work for us, right? So hence Kerajaan Malaysia created Talent Corp, right? Yeah. So di Talent Corp, itu tugas mereka lah untuk bring back this Malaysian talents abroad. So kita macam-macam actually kerajaan Malaysia offer, and alhamdulillah a lot of take up right for the past years, because one of the reason we think that hidup pun semakin susah di certain negara tu, right? That especially now if you can see in US there ada racial punya issues lah kan, in other countries also ada sentiments terhadap certain Asian, so makes it life, and in the end it goes back to quality of life, right? So so macam for professional talent corp offer macam-macam. Siapa siapa yang returning expat program tu, dia offer attractive living and financial incentive for perempuan. I think for ladies who dah cuti untuk give birth, right, dia ada offer career comeback program. Lepas tu dia offer resident, maknanya ada overseas expat yang tinggal di Malaysia, dia offer. Orang tu nak tak lagi kerja di Malaysia, dia offer lagi opportunity. So these are the ways kerajaan Malaysia, ada program-program yang kerajaan Malaysia offer, and alhamdulillah we can see a lot of take up from that. And yang ada ramai Malaysian yang nak offer diri, because I think in the end it goes back to dia nak serve back the country after being abroad for so long, right? So yeah, but in the end it goes back to the individual themselves kan. Yeah, so it's hard to control that.
Right.
Okay, thank you Miss Ezzwanee.
All right.
All right. So all right, so we have our have room for one last question in the chat box. It's like greeting Miss Ezzwanee, how do we persuade our parents to believe in us if we have a strong desire to work abroad and come from a strict family?
Okay. Alhamdulillah saya ni dibesarkan di dalam family yang quite open-minded. Alright. So, they are religious. My parents are religious. But somehow, dia tahu anak dia seorang ni. I'm the only girl in my family. Alright. I have two brothers. But I'm the one working abroad. So in the end, it's about showing your family how responsible you are. Okay? Kena tunjuk ni dekat parents ni, sebagai especially sebagai anak perempuan. Anak lelaki ni selalu parents tak ada hal sikit, dia boleh lepaskan. Right? Anak perempuan ni, anak perempuan ni, you kena tunjukkan kat your parents that you are capable, you are independent woman. Alright? Apa-apa you dapat buat decision yang betul, yang takkan merisaukan dia. Tunjukkan tu semua. Right? That you are able to make good decisions as a woman. Alright? So kalau you tak dapat tunjukkan tu semua, mak bapak mana tak risau nak lepaskan anak pergi kerja abroad. Right? Another thing, when it comes to a very strict, religiously strict family, selalunya is religiously strict family. So when you come from a religious strict family, it's a bit hard, right? So because kita ni, walau semodern mana pun, kita, we have batasan-batasan yang perlu kita live by, right? So, but my experience and my advice, from my advice and my experience is that you kena ingat in the end basic ajaran agama, right? So if you ingat tu semua and then you tunjukkan kepada parents you that you are an independent woman who is able to make good decisions for yourself, I think lama-lama dia akan percaya kepada anak dia, right? So I think ada juga lelaki yang susah juga sebab kadang-kadang parents rely on you kan sebagai anak lelaki untuk jaga family, right? Ah, yes. It goes to back to that. It's the same thing as well, right? So you have to tell your parents that you are trying to make a better choices or better to get better experiences in your life in order to serve the family well and serve the family better. So you can explain to them, tunjukkan diorang to them that you are able to do all these things. Jangan bagi dia sikit ruang pun. Ah, kau ni tak boleh buat ni. Jangan. You kena tutup.
Kat Malaysia macam ni. Kat sana lah macam
ah, tu. Yes. Kat Malaysia pun tak betul lah. Dia jangan kat
orang sini.
Yeah, it's hard. Because when you live in overseas, yang mak bapak risau ni, banyak temptation. Itulah. Cakap saya dengan aku. Banyak temptation dekat luar ni. So you have to be strong in your principles. Right? Sebagai seorang perempuan pun kita kena jaga diri kita, right? Yes, when we work we have to be open sebab kita jumpa ramai orang, kita jumpa ramai lelaki, kita jumpa ramai orang single juga kalau you single, kalau you kahwin pun you jumpa lagi orang-orang lain yang open to all these temptations, right? So in the end you yourself have to be strong enough to resist all those temptations, right?
Ramailah nak jadi independent woman nampaknya.
Yeah, of course.
Girl power.
Yes, I'm all about women empowerment because I live in a family where they encourage me to be a strong independent woman. So I encourage those ladies, especially young ladies out there, to be more confident in yourself. Of course kita ada limitations kita, but that limitation does not mean that you cannot do certain things, right? Right. So sama juga lelaki. Right. You ada limitations you juga, tapi at the same time you kena ingat responsibility sendiri and also apa opportunities yang you can get out there to improve your own well-being, right? And at the same time I always encourage young men to respect women out there. All right? It starts with all the men to respect the women. So kalau sama-sama tu work together, insyaAllah we can do better things.
Yeah,
right?
Yes. So I guess there are no more questions from the audience.
Right.
Okay, thank you Miss for the informative and helpful answer.
Alright, thank you.
I will pass to our host.
Right.
Okay, so from what I can conclude that working abroad is becoming popular these days for various reasons. And everyone wants to grab the opportunities untuk tambah pengalaman diorang and so on. It does have some challenges macam susah nak dapat visa, susah nak adjust diri dengan new situation or being discriminated macam Miss sendiri yang lalui. And Miss juga tadi ada mention that quality of life kita pun boleh menurun bila kita duduk dekat luar negara jadi secondary class kan. But despite that, working abroad also has a lot of benefit macam saya tengok gambar-gambar Miss yang Miss bagi tu, Miss banyak travel for work trip and so on. So I feel like kalau kita work abroad ni, it open up an opportunity untuk orang go out and explore the world. So best betul saya tengok Miss travel to various country tu, mesti banyak pengalaman kan?
Of course. So, just to add, it has working abroad and living abroad, and if you don't have that opportunity to work or live abroad, just travel. You can learn so much by traveling and open your perspectives. So yes, by opening up your perspective, you can learn more.
Yeah. Right? So thank you, Miss Ezzwanee, for taking the time to speak to us today, especially on a very important topic of working abroad. I really think we learned a lot today. So thank you again for sharing your experience with us today.
Thank you. Okay, thanks to everyone for having me, giving me the opportunity to talk and share my experiences. Hopefully everyone can dapat sikit something that can be brought on to your life sikit sebanyak. By all means, like for me, I think Azwin also have the same sentiments that kita ni cuba. We are open to help the youth, you know, to improve yourselves. And if any one of you who needs an assistance, kan, mana-mana kalau kokok rasa-rasa personal or professional, you wanna get advice, not just from me, maybe I can introduce to other colleagues of mine or some Malaysians here who are really into helping the youth of today. By all means, kita can set up a working, you know, support mentor mentee program ke kan? By all means, I'm open for it.
So we are already at the end of our talk. sadly, but before we end our session today, I would like to invite Madam Azwin to give a few words and Miss Ezzwanee.
Thank you so much. Alhamdulillah to my host. Yeah. So first and foremost, I would like to express my highest gratitude to my long lost friend and my classmate. Eh? This was my, we were in the same class, just like all of you. We were in the same class, and after we graduated, we went separate ways because we had different interests. But alhamdulillah, we've always been in touch once in a while. But of course, Mrs. Ezzwanee has always been on the other side of the world. At one time, we were neighbors in South America, but we never get a chance to meet one another. We almost did. But tak ada rezeki kan orang kata. But it is a real honor to actually have you back. And sama-sama we serve back as alumni. So I am very proud to have my own classmate to come back and share with my student today. Eh? So at least they learn. Banyak yang we have learned today. Many when I give lecture, oh madam macam mana nak pergi luar negara, ha mes ini I bawa, ha, you know, dah jumpa dah dengan orang yang betul-betul ada experience luar negara. I think you have learned a lot from here today's session, and you have to keep all the advice in what Miss Ezzwanee has listed out tadi. Sebenarnya I can very much relate to whatever Miss Ezzwanee has shared because I went through that period myself. So now maybe you tak boleh nak bayangkan benda tu because you belum lagi step out of the country. You know, the minute you step out of the country, maybe muka Miss Ezzwanee akan terbayang-bayang, oh my god, she warned me already, you know, like oh my god, things like that. So you finally get a chance. Hopefully kalau ada rezeki one day we can actually go and visit Hong Kong kalau Mrs. Ezzwanee masih ada di sana lagi. Kan? So we can actually meet face to face. Experience ni is very expensive. Yeah, experience is very expensive. That's why we always stress to the students, to my student. Whatever you want to do, gain experience. In fact, 2 days ago, we had a session on experience versus quality qualification. Today, Ms. Ezzwanee reiterate balik benda tu. So obviously, you like it or not, when you graduate, you cannot be too picky. You have to grab all the opportunities you can in order to try, and then you will realize your passion dekat mana. You know, sometimes I tried many odd jobs even before. So before I actually like, oh, maybe I should be in the teaching profession, you know. So maybe because when I was in university, saya suka berdiri kat depan, bercakap kan. So kata, tak apalah, saya kerja ni lah kan. So alhamdulillah, I enjoyed teaching. And of course, Miss Ezzwanee enjoyed what she's doing as well. We can see that from her sharing today. She really loved what she's doing. Okay. Betul tak? Okay, so I would like to congratulate my student host for organizing today's event. It is a very fun and very chill evening. Eh? Kita tak ada berat sangat masalah. Eh? Sebenarnya saya nak minta Miss Ezzwanee share, tunjuk sikit kan gambar. Kalau ada boleh nampak Hong Kong kan daripada tinggi.
Oh, alamak. Okay, I tukar background sikit eh.
Boleh.
Background is actually view.
Tak rasa my... juga ni kat Hong Kong ni kan. Bila lagi.
Sekejap, boleh. Background.
So kita mesti jadi jakun sikit.
You cakap-cakap dulu, I cari dulu background.
Okay. you have done really well. Banyak eh. This skill of hosting PD Talk is also a skill that all of you should have. There is a reason why I expose you to this thing. Miss Ezzwanee dah explain dah tadi. Nak cakap dengan speaker, macam-macam orang ada kat luar tu. Ada yang pelik, you all practice kan? Kalau macam mana kalau speaker kita tanya soalan, dia jawab satu je. Ha, macam mana? Ha, kan? So, ada je kan? Kadang-kadang saya suruh speaker-speaker tu, okay, nanti kalau student saya cakap, jangan jawab. Macam tu kan. So, bagi test macam mana dia nak ni. So, ini real life experience tau you dapat. Okay. Wow, look at that. Look at Hong Kong, guys.
This view is actually my house view. I live very high on the 41st floor on top of a hill. So this is the view from my house. So yeah, it's a view of Hong Kong Island, and the further the building sini tu, mana? building yang tinggi situ tu, it's actually Kowloon side.
Oh.
So this is some Hong Kong and a very clear day.
So dekat Hong Kong ni semua high rise lah. Ada ke landed property at all?
Ada landed property. Mostly dekat behind this view ni ada one big hill, the peak. If you've ever been to Hong Kong, dia ada the peak. So the peak ni banyak rumah orang kaya-kaya lah, orang billionaire. And then sebelah Kowloon tu sendiri pun ada banyak banglo-banglo jugalah. Tapi untuk orang kaya saja.
Orang kayangan je. Okay, thank you so much for sharing. And to all the participant, thank you for staying until 5. Kita pun dah sampai waktu kita dah. So itu saja. I hope I can work with you again, Mrs. Ezzwanee, in the future. We can work on various platform later, insyaAllah. Kalau dah boleh jumpa, mana tahu we can actually pay you a visit wherever you are in the world, okay?
InsyaAllah.
So please take care of yourself. We pray for your safety over there and for your health, okay? So assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Win. So that's it?
Belum. You nak saya jadi host ke? Nak saya jadi host apa? Semua dah berhenti kerja dah.
So thank you Madam Azwin and Miss Ezzwanee.
Please, I pun ada Instagram. Do follow me. You can see a lot more.
Can you guys type dekat group tu?
Boleh.
So you can you can basically see how I live my life and work in Hong Kong lah.
Yes.
All right, see you everyone on Instagram, insyaAllah.
Okay, everybody.
Go back, thank kita jumpa.
Thank you so much.
To the two winners, nantikan hadiah. Nantikan hadiah,
nanti saya bagi alamat ya. Saya bagi
alamat. Azwin Azmi Aksan, PM tepi.
Kena selotok ni.
Okay, bye ya.
Thank you so much. Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.